And then talk.
Myself, Marishwari from Ramaya Medical College. I'm working under Dr. Vijay Kumar, sir. Today I'm presenting a case of Pillamma, 80 years old female, hailing from Chikbalapur, housewife by occupation, presenting with the chief complaints of loose stool since 15 days and complaints of swelling in front of the neck since 15 days. Coming to a history of presenting illness, patient was apparently normal 1 month back, following which she developed loose stools for a period of 15 days. 10 to 15 episodes per day, watery stools not associated with blood or mucus, no history of abdomen pain or vomiting, there is a history of generalized weakness. For the above mentioned complaints, patient was admitted in a local hospital for 1 week, where she was treated conservatively with IV fluids, and she was found to have a swelling in front of the neck, for which she was referred to our hospital. History of swelling in front of the neck noticed by a consultant in a local hospital 15 days back. There was no progression in size since then, not associated with pain. There was a history of weight loss, which was not quantifiable. There are no other history of hyperthyroid features. There's no history of hypothyroid features, no history of compression symptoms like dyspnea, dysphagia, or hoarseness of voice. There's no history of any goitrogen intake or history of similar complaints in the neighborhood. Past history, no history of radiation exposure to chest or neck in the childhood or in the past. Patient has not undergone any FNACs or biopsies of the swelling in the past. There are no known medical comorbidities. Family history, no history of any thyroid swellings in the family. Personal history, appetite is normal, sleep is disturbed, bladder habits are regular, bowel movements are altered with no addictive habits.
Can we stop here?
Yes, sir.
Can you go to the first page of your history?
Yes, sir.
First page, further down. You first thing is that you will not put a next slide.
Sorry, sir.
Next slide.
Next, okay.
You will not put the name of the patient. That is absolutely wrong. You cannot do that, right? Okay. So you can put name as Mrs. X or Miss X or Mr. Y or whatever.
Female patient like that.
A female. Okay. That is number one that you should not do. Okay. Number two in your history, go to next slide, please.
See.
Now this basically, you have made a long story here because it is just an incidentally discovered swelling in front of the neck. You could have said it in a much smaller and a shorter way rather than giving a full history of how many stools that he had or she had. It was just basically a coincidental finding. You could have cut down on this slide. We want less number of slides. We want our slides less crowded. And we want to hear what exactly is the problem with the patient. Next slide, please. I would remove this.
Okay.
Right. Now, you have a swelling in front of the neck and there's no progression in size. Any of the other examiners want to ask anything on this?
I want to come in here. In the neck. And loose stools. Anything else you think of?
Sorry, sir?
A patient coming with a swelling in the neck and complaints of loose stools also.
Yes, sir. I would think in terms of medullary and ask about abdominal complaints, hypertension, past history.
Okay. But at this age of 80, not...
Medullary is most common in fifth to sixth decade. She noticed it 15 days back, which was noticed by someone else.
Madam?
Sir?
Madam, this patient has never ever had any symptoms related to the swelling of the neck. Neither has the patient complained about it. It is noticed by the doctor.
Yes, sir.
Did the doctor, according to you, tell anything to the patient, the importance that she should get investigated at the age of 80?
No, sir. She was directly referred to Ramaya and she came to our hospital for the above complaints. That's it.
So basically, she just blindly followed the doctor who told her you get investigated.
Yeah, she actually doesn't give a complaint of anything. Even after examining, I mean, while asking questions also, she's like, I don't have any problem because doctor said I've come here.
truly, as a doctor in an 80-year-old, would you have the courage of telling her you don't require investigations, go back?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Sir. She's
8. I'm looking at my grandmother.
Yes.
And she must be having this swelling for a long time. I would ask the relative, son or somebody, how long is this swelling there? He would tell me 15 years, 20 years.
But she's having diarrhea since 15 days and she doesn't have any other complaints of like acute gastroenteritis or an abdominal complaints to correlate with.
Did you ask?
I agree with you because medullary carcinomas or any other thyroid problem is likely to give rise to diarrhea. How many times and what is the type of diarrhea that a patient will have, medullary carcinoma or any other thyroid? One episode only? And the patient?
No, sir. Multiple episodes.
Multiple. There is nothing in your history that is written there that where there are multiple episodes.
Yes, sir.
Is there anything written there?
No.
Sir, I've written almost like 10 to 15 days watery stools, not associated with any blood or mucus.
One episode.
Sir?
It's only one episode, right?
10 to 15 episodes, sir.
10 to 15 episodes per day.
Per day.
Go ahead. Let's discuss. We have to
discuss. Maris, this is an 80-year-old lady with diarrhea with swelling in the neck, which you think is medullary carcinoma. Now, what is the importance of this patient in relation to the family? I mean, why do you want to treat this patient? And what is the importance of this patient?
So, medullary is associated with familial syndrome like Men syndrome. Hello?
Right.
Am I audible, sir? Hello?
You get it in hyperthyroidism.
Yes.
You get the loose motion in hyperthyroidism.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hyperthyroidism patient
also. Hyperthyroidism.
Hyperthyroidism and medullary carcinoma. He doesn't have any other complaints of hyperparathyroidism or hypoparathyroidism except for the diarrhea, and there is a history of weight loss which is not very significant, which is not quantifiable.
Why do you
I have a point to make.
Okay, right.
Now, you have said that this history is only 15 days. Have you asked her how long has she had this swelling for? This might have been there for years, as Otav has said. And I think she's right.
Yes, she might have had it for a long time.
So, why have you asked her that?
Yes, sir. But she has not noticed. Nobody has noticed in the family. It was noticed by a doctor in the hospital. She doesn't have an idea of swelling in the neck.
That is good that you have said as a notice. That is good.
Okay.
Right.
How do you explain compression symptoms like dysphagia in a case of period?
How do I explain a compression symptoms like?
Dysphagia. Thyroid swelling.
Compression symptoms.
Hoarseness of voice. Stridor.
No, I am asking dysphagia. Will the thyroid compress the esophagus or pharynx?
Basically, there is a narrowing of the trachea, which causes.
So it has to compress on the trachea, then again compress on the esophagus.
Only if it involves the entire encasement, then there will be a
lateral movement. The lobe can go laterally and posteriorly. The compression from
the only if it encases the trachea, there will be involvement of the esophagus at a later stage.
The voice in thyroid.
Sir, your voice is not
audible. Thyroid comes to you with a hoarseness of voice. What do you will think?
Hoarseness of voice. I will evaluate in terms of compression symptoms, sir. Vocal cord for the
hoarseness of voice in a thyroid.
Recurrent laryngeal nerve.
No, it is very very rare.
The compression of the trachea can also lead to hoarseness of voice.
Hypothyroidism is the commonest cause for hoarseness of voice in a thyroid.
Hypothyroidism.
It does not jump into only this one.
Okay.
Go ahead. You know history of goitrogen intake. What is that?
So she doesn't have any history of consumption of any drugs or food containing excessive.
In India,
which drug?
Cabbage, kale.
Cabbage causes goitrogen. What is the mechanism? The cabbage, when you take with the cooked form, it will not cause any goitrogenic effect. The thiocyanate will just, when you boil it for more than 40 degree, it will get tasted. Or the flavonoid, which is in the soya beans. So we are not using it as a raw. And these are not the goitrogens in Indian setup.
Okay.
Which drugs do you think is commonly used?
Lithium, amidorin, and paraminosalicylic acids, and
lithium is very common because lithium is used as an antipsychotic drug.
Antipsychotic drug.
And it's very common.
Right. Next slide, please. Right. What is the history of radiation that you asked?
Sir, for any lymphomas, mantle just radiation in the childhood. But yeah.
Okay.
Is a low dose radiation important or a high dose?
Yeah, sir. Low dose before they used to treat.
Which is more dangerous? Low dose or high dose?
High dose, sir.
What's the difference between the two? How much?
More than 30 millicuries more expected to have.
It's about 100 times and 300 times. Low dose causes 100 times chances of malignancy. High dose.
Low dose has 100 times more chances of causing
malignancy. And high dose has 300 times.
Okay.
Now, we still have similar swelling in the neighborhood.
To rule out endemic, sir, that was supposed to be
endemic.
Hello?
What is endemic?
This is endemic.
If a place in a place where there is iodine, they consume less iodine content, or when there is excess of fluoride content in the water, they are more prone for.
How much percentage of population should be affected to be called endemic? Yeah,
call it as endemicity. What is the definition?
Ten to 20%, I think. 10 to 20.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, please.
Okay. Coming to general physical examination, an elderly lady is moderately built and nourished, conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented, with an ECG score of 1 and a BMI of 16.5 kg per meter square. And attitude is patient is calm and relaxed. There is dry, scaly skin, muscle wasting noted, no eye signs or tremors, no pallor, cyanosis, clubbing, icterus, lymphadenopathy, or edema. Vital signs, pulse rate 92 beats per minute, measured in the right arm, right forearm radial artery, regular, normal rhythm, normal in character, volume, and vessel wall thickness is normal. BP is 110 by 70 millimeter Hg in the right arm brachial artery, respiratory rate 18 cycles per minute, and temperature is afebrile at the time of examination. Coming to a local examination, an inspection, there's a swelling in the thyroid region measuring about 4 into 3 cm, extending between the two anterior borders of the sternocleidomastoid horizontally and vertically from 1.5 cm from the prominence of the thyroid cartilage to 3 cm above the sternal notch. All the borders are well defined, including the lower border. Surface appears nodular with a dominant nodule of size 1 into 1 cm in the right lobe of the thyroid. Swelling moves up with deglutition. Skin over the swelling is normal. And there are no prominent veins noted over the swelling. Skin appears normal. No scarring or no scars or no sinuses noted. And no other swellings in the neck. Thyroid appears normal in position.
What's the shape?
Sir?
Shape.
Oval shape. It's an irregular shape. I can see it as an irregular shape.
On inspection, what is trial sign you did not mention?
Trial sign, that's thyroid, the trachea appears normal in position. In case of deviation of trachea, there will be prominence of the sternal head on the side of the deviation. The hollowness is lost. Coming to palpation, there's no local rise of temperature, no tenderness. Size of 4 into 3 cm in the greatest horizontal and vertical dimension is noted. Extent, shape, and borders are confirmed. borders are well defined, including the lower border. Surface is nodular. Consistency is firm. Mobility moves up with deglutition and it is mobile with the trachea. Skin over the swelling is pinchable. On Lahey's method, there is a left lobe palpable, no nodules felt. On the right side, there is a single nodule of around a single nodule of 1 into 1 centimeter palpable, but the rest of the lobe is not palpable. On Cocker's test, there is no stridor. On Cryell's method, there is nodularity noted. Plane of the swelling is deep to deep fascia. Trachea is central in position. Carotid pulsations are palpable at the normal position, that is at the level of a thyroid cartilage at the level of C6 thoracic, transverse process of the C6 cervical vertebrae. There's no cervical lymphadenopathy. Auscultation, there's no Bruhi heard over. There's no Bruhi heard over the upper pole of the thyroid.
How do you say that, come down, how do you say that this swelling is deep to the deep fascia?
So one is on putting the, just on move, it moves with the deglutation, up and down with deglutation. Oh. One is that.
So does that mean it is fixed to deep fascia? Deep, no. deep fascia.
Extension, just on extension of the neck, you can feel that the swelling is decreasing in size. And otherwise, on putting the sternocleidomastoid on contraction by turning the head towards the opposite side against resistance, you can see the swelling decreasing in size.
That you can do only one side of the sternocleidomastoid.
One side.
Both the sternocleidomastoid together.
No, sir. At a time, we can't do once.
Both together.
You can contract both the sternocleidomastoid just pressing onto your chin.
How did you examine the thyroid? Like what position did you examine? Where
are
you
standing?
From standing behind the patient, I examined the.
What is
physical? So you must say standing behind, on the side, and in front.
And front.
You have to say that first examining the patient from behind, and then you come in front for the Lahey's method. To see the posterior border of the thyroid. What is the Pizzolo's method of thyroid examination?
Sir, Pizzolo's method is used in case of obese people or short neck people for a proper evaluation of the thyroid swelling.
So what do you do?
You ask the patient to extend the neck and put her both the arms at the occiput.
Right.
You have to press against the palm.
Press against the occiput.
Maury, you have missed some very important examinations. You have not examined the leg of the patient for pre-tibial myxedema. You have not examined the reflexes.
Nodes.
Sir, okay.
And you have not examined for the proximal muscle weakness.
And nodes as well.
No cervical lymph nodes.
Okay.
How do you examine for proximal muscle weakness?
We asked the patient to... get up from the sitting position.
You can put a hand on the chair and get up. Without using any...
Without using any support, you should ask the patient to get up from the sitting position.
Dr. Maheshwari, this Cryell's method, is it indicated in the... What is the size of this swelling to go for a Cryell's method? It's a 4 centimeter, you are saying.
4 into 3 centimeter.
Is it... indicated the Cryell's method is for a very small swelling, or it is a dominant nodule of an MNG. It is 1 centimeter. I think it's 1 centimeter. Then only we go for a Cryell's. Otherwise, it is such a 4 centimeter size swelling. We won't adopt the Cryell's method.
What is
that?
Okay.
What is the Cocker's test? Why you have done the Cocker's test?
Cocker's test is to rule out compression of the trachea. That is, we. Hold the thyroid swelling on both sides with the thumb and the lateral, and look for any stridor.
What is it?
So what if the trachea is compressed? So what?
What is the important?
Look for the tracheomalacia, basically scabbard trachea, at the later stage during
surgery. Tracheomalacia,
sir.
What do you mean, tracheomalacia?
Softening of the tracheal rings.
No, why do you want the trachea to be remain open always? Your esophagus is not remain open. Only when you eat, your esophagus will open. Why do you want the trachea to remain open?
We have to breathe. Yeah.
When you breathe, it will open.
But if there is softening, then there will be collapse of the trachea.
Not like esophagus or any other structure. Trachea needs to be open always.
Open always.
Yes, because there's something coming in and then going out. Coming in and going out.
Going out.
No, but what is the importance of tractor malacia then?
Sir, during the surgery time, after...
What is dead volume in the tidal volume?
Tidal volume is 500, sir.
What is that? Dead space volume?
Dead space 150, sir.
So this dead space volume is mandatory to sustain the alveolar exchange always. And if the trachea is closed, there will not be any dead space volume of the air and the exchange cannot take space. That is why we are very particular. The trachea should be remain open. When it goes for tracheomalacia, you are very careful. What is the precaution you will take when you have the Kafka's test is positive?
We do an IDL to look for, during surgery, these are done to take precaution during surgery. While extubating, we have to partially extubate the patient and see if there is any collapse of the trachea. In case if there is collapse of the trachea, then we have to keep the patient intubated. And we have to take a consent for tracheostomy at an earlier stage if there is a stridor.
Must be ready for that.
Keep ready for
tracheostomy. Yeah, keep ready for the tracheostomy.
Can I come in?
Do yes.
Do you think Fokker's test is necessary in this patient?
In this patient, the swelling is not very huge, so not necessary.
That is why all these questions came into picture.
Yes.
If you had not said Fokker's test, I don't think any of the examiners would have grilled you. Came out well. That's good.
Absolutely right, sir.
Go ahead.
Okay. Coming to a systemic examination, respiratory system, bilateral normal vesicular breath sounds heard, no added sounds, no signs of pleural effusion. Cardiovascular system, S1, S2 heard, no palpitation, no tachycardia, no palpitation, no murmurs or arrhythmias, no ectopics heard. Parabdomen examination, it's soft, non-tended, no organomegaly or bowel sounds present. No organomegaly, bowel sounds present. Central nervous system, there is no neurological deficit, all the reflexes are normal. And scalp, there are no palpable swellings.
Wait. Why did you specifically ask for scalp swelling? You are trying to ask me questions about metastasis, etc. Tell me the type of multiple scalp swellings that may occur in patient's body.
In case of follicular carcinoma,
non-thyroid related swellings of the scalp.
Renal cell carcinoma can present with
thyroid. No organ related.
Pure no organ
of the scalp.
De novo.
Like normal lipoma, sebaceous cyst.
Lipoma?
Sebaceous cyst, dermoid cyst.
If there is a sebaceous cyst in the scalp, what are the various complications that you know of?
Infection, sebaceous horn.
Pott's puffy
tumor.
Now you have to differentiate between Cox tumor and Pott's tumor. I don't want to go into, let's go into the case. I'm just trying to tell you, do not pinch an examiner. Something like this. Okay, because insufficiency of the thyroid can go into many other places. So by putting your foot into only scalp, you are scratching an examiner. Okay? Go ahead.
So my differential diagnosis I would like to give is a multinodular goit.
Why you are saying a differential diagnosis? Why don't you say provisional diagnosis?
Because I have given two diagnoses, sir. That's it.
Okay, you tell me.
I would like to consider a following diagnosis, that is multinodular goiter with a dominant nodule in the hyperthyroid state with no compressive symptoms. And my secondary will be a medullary carcinoma of thyroid.
How many nodules you are palpating? You are diagnosing multinodular goiter.
One dominant nodule I'm palpating, and on the left lobe is palpable, isthmus is palpable, but there is not much of a nodularity.
No, when there are palpable nodules, more than one only, you can say multinodular. Otherwise, it sounds like a wishful thinking. There is nodule, palpable nodule. Where is it actually? Whatever you have calculated, right lobe, left lobe, isthmus.
Right lobe, sir.
It was in the right lobe. Okay.
Marcy? Maris?
Yes,
now,
sir.
See the problem with you. Multinodular goiter, agree. Dominant nodule in hyperthyroid state, not agreed. Tell me why I am talking with you when you are telling me that the patient is hyperthyroid state.
So, since there's only one or two symptoms of hyperthyroidism, I would just not want to neglect that and include it as in hyperthyroid state and evaluate for the further thing. There are no specific symptoms of hyperthyroidism here, but diarrhea is very significant, and there is loss of weight, which is very minimal, or which he couldn't quantify. So that's why I put it as a diagnosis, just for an evaluation.
Now I will give you a situation that okay. I come to you as a patient with no thyroid swelling, with the same history. Will you think of hyperthyroid in me?
I would like to rule out other causes of diarrhea and this thing. That one thing I would always keep in mind is a primary thyrotoxicosis.
So you will keep in mind that I will have thyrotoxicosis if I don't become well with the treatment that has been given to me. Here is a patient who has become all right with treatment given without actually doing anything to the thyroid. Why are you putting this? I am little...
When she presented to us, also she continued to have loose stools.
What is your pulse rate?
If you are interrupting the exam, you are going to get into more trouble. Let me finish what I want to ask you.
Yes, sir.
With one episode of history, if you are going to label this patient just because there is a thyroid nodule, hyperthyroid, when the pulse rate is normal, there are no other contributory history to its hyperthyroid state. Yes. I'm going to be a little worried in your diagnosis.
Sir, yeah, she had an history of 10 to 15 episodes per day for a period of almost 10 days. Sir.
What is her pulse rate?
Pulse rate is 92 when she came to our hospital. Correct. 92. She was already...
One minute. When, under treatment for hyperthyroid state or thyrotoxicosis?
When she was admitted in our hospital, she was started on... hyperthyroid drugs. When I was taking the case, she was started on
hyperthyroid. You on treatment with hyperthyroid drugs?
But she was started only like a week back. So
When she came to you, she was taking.
She was taking hyperthyroid drugs when I took the case.
It never came out in your history.
Exactly.
So now
he is telling me you are making up.
No, sir. She was admitted in our hospital, but in a different department.
Whatever
where they had started.
It is a history.
You are not justified in putting hyperthyroidism.
When you are giving me diagnosis and you are not giving me history, patient is on antithyroid drugs, it's the biggest mistake that you can do.
Yeah.
I will let go. I will still let go. You are missing the history. But what is telling me as an examiner is that now that you have started making up and you are hellbent on telling me that what I am saying is correct, which is going to, I cannot irritate me. You are past. But I am just trying to tell you, it can irritate an examiner. Be careful.
Okay.
Go ahead. Sir, one more question. See, you are diagnosed hyperthyroidism. That itself is being questioned. You whatever, however inappropriate it might appear, you have to mention all that at least when you mention that as your first option in the differential diagnosis, number one. And when that only nodule what you have computed, you are implicating the cause of hyperthyroidism. What is the name of the disease?
Sir, only nodule?
Multinodularity, one nodule become autonomous and it has produced hyperthyroidism. So what do you call that?
Autonomous toxic nodule.
So it's a Lummis disease, hyperthyroidism
secondary to multinodular.
Nodules are normally can perceive as not functioning. So when you implicate a nodule as a functioning and a cause of hyperthyroidism, it is Lemmas disease. When the internodular tissue is going to hyperact, it is going to come in primary thyrotoxicosis. This is secondary thyrotoxicosis, secondary to your nodule.
What are the points in favor of medullary carcinoma in this case? Your diagnosis, different diagnosis.
One is the age, sir. Age of the patient. And with the thyroid swelling, with the diarrhea.
Age is the patient, is not everything.
Hello, sir. Voice is breaking, sir. I can't hear you.
8th decade is not the decade for the medullary carcinoma.
But older age, more than 60.
One thing I would like to point out, Manisha, is that do not confront the examiner. Do not argue with the examiner in an examination situation, as Dr. Abhay said. You are cheesing him off because your diagnosis of a diarrhea with a thyroid swelling and with no other signs of hyperthyroidism, you cannot justify your diagnosis.
Yes.
In no way can you justify. How many cases of medullary carcinoma has any of these consultants seen in their life? It's a very rare condition.
Rare condition.
15 days history, you are labeling your second diagnosis as medullary carcinoma thyroid. It was not acceptable. Number one. Number two, even your first diagnosis, multinodular goiter with the dominant nodule, there are no signs of hyperthyroidism. It could just be a solitary nodule of the thyroid. That's my opinion.
What about the response to the drug?
Response to drugs in an antithyroid medicine, when you start, it takes about 1 to 8 weeks for it to start. 1 week is a very early time. It takes about 8 weeks for it to start giving effect. How can your diarrhea go away with 2 days of medication? I cannot understand. That's number one. And in fact, it takes, even with antithyroid medicines to get the thyroid hormone, it might take months to get the thyroid level normal. So I will not accept your diagnosis in any way of an hyperthyroidism of the goiter.
Sorry to interrupt. I would say the faculty give now a working diagnosis. And from there, please take her, allow her to complete the management part of it. Let us give one working diagnosis for her. And then take her through the management and the operative part of the
Okay, go ahead.
Prabhat sir, I think you should give her a working diagnosis.
Yes. My diagnosis in this patient is multinodular goiter without compressive symptoms requiring further investigations. That's all.
Perfect, sir. With that, shall we move on,
sir? Let
the girl proceed.
Yes, who led to differential diagnosis?
Okay, sir.
Enough. I think Marcus should go ahead on how do you.
I think we should. Yeah, investigate. How do you investigate?
I would like to get
the investigation.
I would like to get a thyroid profile test first.
Let's say it is normal.
Okay. Then I would get an ultrasound and an FNAC.
Ultrasound shows nodularity similar to what you have palpated. FNSC shows colloid goiter. Colloid material only. Now go ahead.
Since the colloid, the nodule is very small, we can just monitor the patient.
What is the size of the nodule?
The dominant nodule is 1 into 1 centimeters.
Do you do anything for a size of a nodule which is less than 1 centimeter?
Nothing, sir. Just monitor. Just monitor the patient.
Okay.
Exactly.
Now your FNAC tells you that there are follicular cells which are seen. Now what do you do?
Follicular cells, we have to repeat the FNAC, sir.
Again,
if it is still inconclusive,
follicular cells are seen.
Follicular cells, then...
Before that, ask you, what is the Betsida classification for thyroid 1, thyroid 2, thyroid 3?
Betsida class, non-diagnostic? Non-neoplastic?
No. What is one?
Non-diagnostic, sir.
What do you mean by non-diagnostic?
FNAC shows non-diagnostic. This doesn't give any
insufficiency. Right. Okay. And what two?
Two is non-neoplastic. Three is ATP of unknown significance or follicular
cell seen.
Lesion of undetermined significance.
So this would be THY3. So what Dr. Abhay is asking is basically T3. Okay. THY3. Right. So how do you proceed now?
We have to do a hemithyroidectomy for this patient, sir. Then with the histopathology report, we'll do a definitive management in case of... Hello?
80-year-old female, if you want to do hemithyroidectomy?
In case of in case of follicular cells, the chances of malignancy is around 32 to 40%. So, considering our age, I would like to monitor, but if it is an otherwise patient, then you have to do a hemithyroidectomy.
Best thing is to say, you will get the input from the ultrasonogram of the left lobe. They might delineate subclinical nodules. If there are subclinical nodules, better say total thyroidectomy.
Exactly. How can you do a hemithyroidectomy in a multinodular goiter? Is that acceptable?
No, the solitary nodule. Okay, if it is a multinodular, you cannot do a hemithyroidectomy. It is always a total thyroidectomy or a near thyroidectomy.
Okay, I think just a minute. I think we are going very off track, and we should be more systematic in our approach. Let us start off with the investigation first. Yes. Let us do one by one. Get the investigation, and then go to the treatment. What are you going to see? Suppose your case is there, as you said, is a multinodular goiter. What you said investigation that you do is an ultrasound. What are you going to see in ultrasound? And what are the characteristics of a malignant nodule on an ultrasound?
On an ultrasound, we have to see for the echogenicity, hypoechoic or hyperechoic. Then we see for the irregular cells, cystic or solid component, microcalcifications, and taller than wider cells. So if all these...
What else?
Vascularity.
Vascular. Increased vascular. Lymph nodes.
What else? Yes.
So can you extension.
Can you repeat that? Can you repeat that again? 1, 2, 3, 4. In a very clear fashion for all the residents to hear.
So echogenicity, that is hypoechoic.
Hypoechogenicity, number one. Hypoechogenicity. Number two, cystic microcalcification.
Microcalcification. Cystic or solid component.
Irregular borders,
taller than wider cells.
Absence of peripheral halo.
Absence of peripheral halo.
Intrathyroidal vascularity and lymphadenopathy. So these are the 5 or 6 points that you have to see in a case, in an ultrasound, to distinguish between a benign and a malignant nodule. Right? So, and what do you see in the nodes? Now, suppose there are some nodes there which you have found out. What will you see in the nodes? What ultrasound would you like to? What will the ultrasound give the picture?
Loss of medulla.
Or an ultrasound. See, ultrasound in any malignant nodule, node, when what happens? What is the shape of a normal lymph node? It is kidney shaped. Isn't it? Bean shape, I would say. Bean shape. The hilum is at the middle part, right? So when you get metastatic cells from there, how does it change the shape of the node?
It becomes irregular in shape and there is loss of hilum.
It becomes not
irregular.
Rounded. It will be usually just longer and wide. Now it becomes rounded. Most important. Then you can see microcalcification also in the lymph node, and there will be hypervascularity of the node. Right. So these are the two or three things that you will see on an ultrasound in the on the lymph node, right?
Okay.
What are the blood tests that you have done?
Thyroid profile test I've done.
Anything else you want to do?
A CT scan?
Sir?
CT scan will you do?
If it is a multimodal or goiter, it's not required, sir, unless there is an retrosternal extension.
If there is,
when would you like to, yeah, CT, we'll talk about the CT later on. When would you do a thyroid scan? What are the indications of doing a thyroid scan in a multinodular goiter?
When there is primary thyrotoxicosis, thyroid scans, ultrasound. Oh, hello.
Isotope scan.
Only when there is autonomic toxic nodules and primary thyrotoxicosis. Otherwise, for a follow-up case of differentiated carcinomas, we'll do a radioisotope scan.
When you have a multinodular goiter, right, there are many nodules in that. So what you see, if the TSH value is very low, that means it is a toxic nodule is going. In that case, you would like to do a isotope scan to see if that is a hot nodule or not, right?
It is not going to help us in the management, because being a warm nodule or a cold nodule, multinodular goiter, after treating hyperthyroidism, patient has to undergo a total thyroidectomy.
Adam, I did not ask you that. I just asked you a simple question. What is the indication, or under what condition would you like to do a thyroid scan in a multinodular goiter? The question is very straightforward. That is only indication. When the TSH is very low, is a dominant nodule, which is secreting the thyroid, in that case you have to do a radioisotope scan, right? What is the indication of C? Yeah, okay, fine, carry on.
Why do you want to do that radioisotope scan?
Sir, it will give us a...
same finding, suppose the patient has a transient hyperthyroidism. What do you mean by transient hyperthyroidism? Transient hyperthyroidism. How will you differentiate a Graves disease from an autonomic other autonomic disease?
Autonomous toxic, sir, I'm not hearing you properly. How do you differentiate?
How will you differentiate a Graves disease where there is a hyperthyroidism from this autonomic disorder?
Autonomic toxic nodule, it's independent. It produces TSH, which is independent. It basically suppresses the remaining part of the gland, and only the autonomous toxic nodule that will be active. Whereas in Graves' disease,
my question is: in Hashimoto's thyroiditis, will you get a hyperthyroidism?
Yes, sir.
How will you differentiate that from a Graves' disease? You have a hyperthyroidism from Hashimoto's thyroiditis that is called transient hyperthyroidism.
Yes, sir.
How will you differentiate it from a Graves' disease? No, a patient with a transient hyperthyroidism, there is no need for antithyroid treatment. But if it's a Graves disease, you need to give a treatment. You have to evaluate whether it's a transient or original hyperthyroidism.
Okay.
So this radioisotope uptake scan helps a lot, because in a Graves disease, there will be a vivid uptake. But when in a Hashimoto's thyroiditis or hyperthyroiditis, there will not be any uptake. Because the follicles are ruptured. There is nothing to be stored.
Okay.
So here, this test is able to help us to differentiate transient hyperthyroidism in a very big way.
Okay.
Right. Now let us come to a scenario in your patient, right? Patient has got, I will give you the finding. Your patient has got multinodular goiter, right? And there is one dominant node, as you said. The patient is euthyroid.
Okay.
There's one node, which is nodule, which is dominant, a big nodule, which is say size of 2 centimeters. Now, how will you go ahead with this? Have you got my question?
Yes.
The scenario. Yes. Is in your case, the multinodular goiter with one big dominant nodule, which is about 2 centimeters in size. patient is euthyroid. How will you proceed now?
So since patient is in euthyroid, I would like to take the FNAC from the dominant nodule.
Okay, good.
And right. Based on that report, we will proceed.
Excellent. So now coming back to Dr. Abhay Dalvi's question. Now, if that FNAC shows some follicular cells, now what will you do?
The multinodular goiter. Multinodular goiter, we have to advise for a total thyroidectomy.
Right. What are the low risk conditions for thyroid malignancy in this, and what are the high risk?
Low risk is age less than 40 and size less than 4 centimeter. And
is it age less than 40?
45, sir. Sorry.
No, it has still less increased. Than, it is now it is less than 50.
Less than?
55.
55. Oh, okay. And grading of the tumor and in metastatic history, vascularity and capsular invasion, all these comes under high risk.
Right. So the surgery that you're planning is a total thyroidectomy.
Yes, sir.
Right. So how do you proceed? How do you prepare the patient?
I would like to get
X-ray
of the neck.
Somebody has asked, I can see a question in the chat. Somebody has asked if molecular markers are important or not. Can you answer him? So I just saw the questions on the thing. Somebody has asked, one of your friends has asked, is there an importance of molecular markers?
No, sir. Hello?
For medullary carcinoma,
we have to do a serum calcitonin levels. Hello. Hello.
No, that's
yes, sir, your question.
Go ahead.
Okay. Serum calcitonin levels we'll check, and serum CEA levels. And yes, sir, based on this and a biopsy, FNAC.
Will you do TrueCut biopsy?
Not for a medullary carcinoma thyroid, sir. But it's only to differentiate between a lymphoma and an anaplastic carcinoma. We would like to do a TrueCut, but still the chances of injury is high.
One more indication you can say is a Riddle's thyroiditis also.
Riddle's thyroiditis.
Right. How do you prepare a patient for a thyroid surgery? Suppose this patient was hyperthyroid.
Hyperthyroid, then we have to treat the patient for hyperthyroidism first with the antithyroid drugs. And we have to treat the patient for antithyroid. After the patient becomes normal, we have to wait at least for 2 months.
Normal or euthyroid? Say euthyroid.
Euthyroid. After the patient becomes euthyroid, you have to wait for 2 months for the surgery.
2 months?
2 months.
Why 2 months?
So the vascularity, everything comes down. And
so it will take
to prevent thyroid crisis.
So you have to ask the patient to go back home and come back after 2 months. Is that right?
Otherwise, 10 days before, for a period of one week, antithyroid. Hello.
You have got the patient in. The patient is hyperthyroid. You have started on the hyperthyroid medicines. The patient has become euthyroid. Now, how do you proceed?
I have to get a IDL for the patient. And IDL, indirect laryngoscopy. Mm-hmm. And we put the patient on Lugol's iodine to reduce the vascularity of the nodule. And
you are still on anti hyperthyroidism. You still believe the patient is an hyperthyroid. That is why you are saying that is Lugol's iodine.
Patient has become euthyroid, then we'll do an IDL and it's X-ray of the neck. proceed for the surgery.
What is the purpose of X-ray?
To look for any narrowing of the trachea or if there is any calcifications.
What is that calcification is called?
Macrocalcification. Peripheral rim calcification.
What is Samoma body?
Samoma bodies are microscopic calcifications of crumpled cells, which is seen in medullary carcinoma.
What type of calcification?
It's a dystrophic calcification.
Good, very good.
What have you done a near total thyroidectomy?
No, sir. Total thyroidectomy.
Have you assisted a thyroidectomy?
Yes, sir. I have assisted a thyroidectomy.
Tell me the position of the patient.
Patient is put in a rose position. That is.
What is this rose? Well, tell me what is rose.
Describe.
I don't understand. Why you all take names?
Patient is put in supine position with a head ring and head ring to support the head and a shoulder bag, and patient is head is slightly extended position.
How do you extend the head of the patient? Extension is at the neck anyway. But how do you do that? How did you do that on the operation table?
And where did you put the pillow?
To get extension.
At the shoulder level, one roll, and to the head, there's a head ring.
Very good.
And put the patient in a slightly extended position.
Very good. Now you have got extension. Anything else that you are very careful about, because you got to know where exactly the midline is? Suppose the patient's head is there on the head ring, but the patient's head is twisted. Is it okay for you?
The chin, we have to look for the chin level and the sternum.
Very good.
Chin now, and the sternum should be in line.
What will you tell the anesthetist, which side the endotracheal tube should be?
Which side will you operate from?
From the
please give right.
See, you are going to stand on the right side of the patient or not? So why the tube should come in your way? The tube should be on the left side. Correct?
Right.
And drape the patient.
You have
painted and draped the patient.
Sir, position ek baar phir se, I think just I'll repeat the position.
Okay.
Position, you put the patient, as you said, supine. This is for the benefit of all the residents. We put the patient in supine, put a shoulder, a bag, a sandbag in the interscapular region, so that you extend the neck. The head should be on the head ring. The arms should be by the side of the patient, on both sides, and pull it down. The shoulders should be pulled down, keep it straight, and the head would be tilted slightly up, about 10 degrees up, so that there is less engorgement. So that is the position of the patient for surgery. Now, next, sir, Dr. Dalvi, please take over.
Now, you must have taken an incision. Where did you take the incision?
Incision 2 centimeters above the sternal notch, extending between the two anterior sternocleidomastoid, horizontal
along,
incision.
Along what lines?
Along the Langer lines.
Very good. How did you, now tell me, what number blade did you use?
Number 10, sir.
10?
10?
15. Blade number 15.
Which, where is this 10 number blade?
15, sir.
Okay, doesn't matter. What was the next layer that was cut?
Sir?
What was the layer that you cut before you started raising the flaps?
Skin, subcutaneous tissue, and the platysma.
Okay.
Then the...
you raised the upper flap
till... Upper flap. Raise the upper flap till thyroid cut, hyoid bone, and lower flap till sternum.
Then what did you do? Or what did you see?
I have to cut the cartilage.
Thyroid cartilage is okay, but if at all you have gone up to the higher, I have no problem. I'm itching to ask you what happens if you go till there, but it's okay. Now you have
what vein will you encounter here in this layer?
Anterior jugular vein.
How is the anterior jugular vein formed?
How it is formed?
Abhay sir, you give answer to your question first, sir. Then I think we should move on.
No, upper border of the tracheal cartilage is enough for me, and up to the suprastradial notch. You can use retractor to keep the flaps away, or you can even take skin stitches to keep the things away. In front of you, many times is this anterior jugular vein. You have to be very careful not to injure it. In case you manage to injure it, you can ligate it without any trouble. Now you have to incise something. What do you incise?
The pretracheal fascia. Vertically, we incise the pretracheal fascia.
How do you know you are in the midline?
Sir?
How do you know you are in the midline?
Between the two sterno. Sternohyoid muscle.
It's the strap muscles. If you can just remember, say the strap. What are the strap muscles? Which ones? Sternohyoid and?
Sternohyoid, sternothyroid.
Thyroid. Would you like to cut them, or would you like to just separate them? If you want to cut them, where do you cut it from? Lower down or higher up? If suppose you have to cut. Because it's a large thyroid, I cannot get access properly. I want to cut that muscle. Will you cut it low down or high up?
Higher up.
Why?
To prevent the injury to the nerve supplying them.
Yeah. What exactly?
Ansa cervicalis
comes down and then goes up. So it is the nerve is supplied from below up. So that is why if you cut the muscle, you have to cut it at a higher level.
Higher level.
Okay. You have
one point I like to add. If you are dealing with a moderate to large thyroid, one can incise the investing layer of deep fascia along the anterior border of sternocleidomastoid. That will fall apart the sternocleidomastoid and it will give an ease, and it may avoid the necessity to cut the strap muscles. This step is given very nicely in Mastery's anatomy book. Probably it is not given in the operative part, but it is given in the anatomy book. So just every time incise the anterior deep layer at the anterior border of sternocleidomastoid, and it will fall apart, and that will give you some space.
Okay.
Now you have the thyroid in front of you. You have the thyroid in front of you.
Okay.
Proceed.
First, I'll start from the right side, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Right. I would like to dissect the upper pole first. Ligate the
what is the first vein to
ligate is the middle vein. Yes. middle thyroid vein.
Why
because for the dissection it will be easier.
Why obviously it will be easier, but why?
Because
why
it, would it be enters easier? From the laterally in between the
No, because the middle thyroid vein is a very short vein and it is directly arising from the internal jugular. So you can avulse it very easily. So you find the vein. If you find it, please ligate it first. Often you don't find it.
One more thing. It is not accompanied by an artery.
Never.
That's why it can avulse very easily. Because your patient is handling and retracting everything. You have no control and it is liable to avulse. Now you go to the upper pole.
Upper pole, we have to dissect between the space of rib, that is an avascular plane.
You are taking names.
Upper.
Forcing me.
Sorry. Upper pole, we have to dissect the superficial thyroid artery. Prevent.
Thyroid artery or superior thyroid?
Superior thyroid artery.
You have ligated and cut it near the upper pole as this. Now, how do you tackle the inferior thyroid?
Uh, infi- inferior thyroid
before, artery. Before inferior, upper way, what is the nerve that is in association with the superior thyroid artery?
External laryngeal nerves.
It's a branch of?
Superior laryngeal nerves.
And what is it supply? Which muscle does it supply?
External laryngeal nerve supplies cricothyroid.
What is the function of cricothyroid?
Tensor of the vocal cords.
So if that is cut, what is the symptom that the patient will get?
If it is cut, the vocal cord lies on the median side, there will be little change in the voice, unilateral cut.
What change? What does the cricothyroid do?
Pop singers.
Monotonous.
It's a tensor of the cord. If you cut that, the high pitch of the voice goes. Okay, now come down to the lower pole.
Lower pole, while dissecting the lower pole, you have to be careful about the rectal and laryngeal now. And we have to do a capsular ligation of the branches of the inferior thyroid artery.
It's in the lower pole. Inferior thyroid artery is in the lower pole?
Sir?
Inferior thyroid artery is in the lower pole. Anywhere else?
And the lower pole.
It is coming from
which artery?
Below upwards.
It's below up. It's a branch of the thyrocervical trunk, sir. It rises upwards.
It comes from below upwards or lateral to medial?
Lateral.
From lateral to medial. From lateral to
medial. When it comes from lateral to medial, it cannot come to the inferior pole.
Inferior.
Let's take it. You have finished thyroidectomy. The patient is gone to the ward. Evening, you get a call saying that patient is breathless. Now, what do you do?
First, I'll look for the hematoma if there is any.
Very good.
Hematoma.
What will you do if there is a swelling in the neck which looks like a hematoma?
I will release the sutures.
Which sutures?
What layer?
The skin and the subcutaneous layer sutures.
Nothing is going to happen. Patient is going to still remain breathless.
Up to what layer you want to open?
Skin, subcutaneous, strap muscles also approximated. Up to deep fascia.
You have to open the deep fascia because that is the one which is preventing the blood to come out. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Suppose this patient's voice is hoarse in the post-operative period. What will you do?
I would like to get an ideal to look for the vocal cord palsy.
Immediately?
After 4 to 5 days. And we start on steroids within 7 days of the surgery and taper it and stop.
And our voice does not improve. How long do you think with a recurrent laryngeal, unilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy, the voice is expected to become not normal but near normal?
6 months speech therapy. Till 6 months we can wait with speech therapy and all. And if it is not improving beyond 6 months, the chances of recovery is less. There might be a degeneration.
Let's say you have done a near total thyroidectomy. What is the post-operative follow-up treatment of such a patient who has successfully undergone this surgery without any complications?
Follow-up. Near total. We have to put the patient on a replacement thyroxine.
Who is by your side on the left? You are again and again, your eyes are moving that side.
Nobody is there, sir. I'm alone.
What is the other thyroid?
Unilateral thyroid. So I was wondering.
My camera is on one side. Okay. So.
Jet box.
What else you look for in the post-operative? Look for any.
On the second 48 hours later, look for any hypocalcemic symptoms like. Carpopedal spasm or chest tox sign positivity. Spasm.
What is the first sign?
Chest tox sign.
No.
Cross chest. Carpopedal spasm. Perioral numbness will be there.
Symptoms. Okay.
Symptom. Perioral numbness.
So what, coming back again to the complications, you have, as Dr. Dalvi has said, you have this patient post-operative period develops respiratory distress. One you said was a hematoma. What else can be there? What are the other causes of a respiratory distress in the immediate post-operative period after a near total thyroidectomy?
One is due to the intubation, there might be laryngeal edema.
Okay, laryngeal edema, fine.
Laryngeal edema.
What else? Hematoma,
laryngeal edema, and laryngeal nerve injury.
Injury, what is more dangerous? Is neuropraxia more dangerous or a neurotemesis more dangerous? You understand what neurotemesis
is? Neurotemesis is more dangerous than neuropraxia.
Why?
Neuropraxia is just to blood supply to that part of...
If you cut both, God forbid, any surgeon does it, but if suppose if you cut both the recurrent laryngeal on left and right side, what will be the position of your cord?
Cadaveric position, sir.
Cadaveric position. So therefore that, yes, you're right. It could be in cadaveric position, which means there is a gap. The patient can still breathe. But if there is bilateral neuropraxia, what happens to the cord? It will come in a adducted position. It comes in a medially adducted position. So patient will stop breathing. So which is more dangerous, neuropraxia or neurotomesis?
Neuropraxia.
And what is the cause of this? Why does neuropraxia cause an adduction of the cords? Any idea?
Because all the other muscles of the larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve, except the cricothyroid, which is the tensor.
Nothing. You're on the wrong track. Nothing to do with that. You know or you don't know? I'll give you the answer.
I don't know.
Say that. You have to boldly say that I don't know, sir. The nerve, both the recurrent laryngeal nerve on the outside are the adductor fibers that come, and the inside are the abductors. So when you cut out the lateral side, the adductors are gone. The patient, the vocal cords become abducted. And when they become abducted, they come in the midline and they can stop. Right, so that what is the problem is that neuropraxia is more dangerous than actually neurotomesis if it is bilateral, of course. Bilateral. What are the other causes of respiratory distress post-operative? You mentioned about
tracheomalacia.
What happens in that scabbard trachea?
There will be softening of the tracheal rings. So post surgery, there will be collapse of the trachea, preventing in respiration. So that's why patient will have
to... Do you know what a scabbard means?
Narrow trachea.
What is meaning of scabbard? Word scabbard.
Literal meaning.
Literal meaning.
Tipu Sultan.
Yes, remember Tipu Sultan. Any hint?
Sword.
No.
Sword? What?
Sword.
Not part of the sheath it is actually.
The place where the sword is kept, that is the scabbard. So that is a flat, closed this thing, right? We call it mian. In Hindi, we call it mian. Mian of the talwar. Mian.
Sword sheath.
It's a tip of a sheath of a sword.
Yes.
The word meaning is tip of a sheath of a sword.
Okay.
Sheath of the sword. Yes. Right. So, what are the other complications of a thyroidectomy? Immediate. How do you, if somebody asks you what are the complications of thyroidectomy, how will you say it? How will you classify and tell the answers?
Intraoperative, immediate postoperative, and late postoperative. Intraoperative, hemorrhage, and injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And tracheomalacia, which might require tracheostomy.
And
immediate postoperative is hematoma, breathlessness, wound in hematoma, breathlessness, skin necrosis, skin wound infection, hypocalcemia, hypocalcemia. Late complications are hypothyroidism and persistent recurrent laryngeal nerve or a permanent hypocalcemia.
Keloid.
Keloid.
What are the newer methods of doing a thyroidectomy?
There's a minimally invasive video-assisted thyroidectomy. Two approaches are there. One is through axillary approach and one is through an intraoral approach.
Robotics
also.
Do you literally search for the recurrent laryngeal nerve when you do surgery? You search for it or you neglect it?
This is an old concept of not seeing the nerve is not damaging the nerve, but at present we have to trace till the entry to the recurrent cartilage and preserve the recurrent laryngeal nerve.
Right, sir. Dr. Kanavegal, should we call it a day?
Yes,
sir. Dr. Abhay.
No, I'm just trying to summarize something. She answered quite well, the last part really well. Only thing, don't use the word this is old concept, new concept.
Yes.
If I am the old chap, then I'm going to come on you. What hurts the maximum is you calling somebody old. So be very careful. There are concepts. Some people like to look for recurrent nerve. Yes. Nobody looks for recurrent nerve. That's the answer to be given. Okay. Very well done. In spite of bombardment, you've done very well.
And I think, sir, this was a very nice initiative by Dr. Kanavegal. It's a very nice initiative, sir. Thank you very much for giving us a chance to come on the platform and spend some time also with residents in this really bad, trying times of the COVID-19. I hope that the lockdown gets over by third wave. Let's see what happens.
Professor Prabal, sir, in fact, to put on record, this is the sixth class we are having.
Oh, I didn't know about this. I'm sorry.
In fact, to put on record today, we have 761 candidates watching across the country. Thank you. And as usual, I'd like to have closing remarks from the faculty. Prabal sir has given the closing remark. Jyoti ma'am, your closing remark for the day.
Yes, sir. Both the PGs presented well, but the second case of a thyroid, a little bit of confusion in the presentation and her diagnosis and all. Symptoms and the diagnosis were not correlating. And one more thing just I want to highlight is when they ask for the how will you proceed, go in a proper manner, which one is given importance to the investigation, and just don't mention that ultrasound of the neck, but for what purpose, what you want to look, because this examiner is going to go on asking you for what purpose you want to do. Before that hand only you are supposed to answer, if I want to do ultrasound of a neck in a thyroid, for what all the points I would like to do it. That is the importance of that. And second one is, don't use the term like a we do. Don't use, you say I do, because you are going to be a surgeon. So you should have a confidence in you, and please see to that some of the candidates use you do. So the examiner will get annoyed. You do means already they have done many cases. So I use a word like I do, and be confident and pertaining to the particular case and whatever the ask is. If you don't know, please say don't know. Especially Dr. Marne, what is her name from Bangalore? You should be confident enough to say that I don't know, because in the whole world, we are not a god to know everything. We are learning, even myself also learning. I asked sir one question because I had a confusion with that. So this is no hesitation to say that I don't know. So this is what I want to convey to the students, and be prepared well before coming, because we will be asked, many examiners are here for you to ask a question and you are the only victim around us, but still you both of you have done a good job. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Professor Hitesh Andarya.
Thank you, sir, for the greatest initiatives. Every time you are on there, I like to, and Vivek sir also.
Thank you, sir.
First student varicose vein did reasonably well. There is always some controversy during the exam between 6 or 4 of the examiner. So it is better to find which way you should swing. It's a swing and it's a reverse swing many times. So this is bound to happen regarding certain tests and investigation. I think the students must know what are the various knowledge of Doppler. Because many a times radiologists might be showing only the size of the perforators. What you are supposed to know is the reflux compared to the different measurements. And the second student, I'll say that she tried to show us that she has not gone through the reports. She tried to show us that she doesn't know that she is hyperthyroid, and then she jumped onto hyperthyroidism. So for God's sake, each and every student, you either in exams, you should be given the reports, then I'm fine with that. Or you should not go with the reports or whatever the colleagues have said to you. You just go as a de novo case, as if you are examining for the first time. As far as history of the hyperthyroidism is concerned, you should have taken the history, what type of drugs she takes, from what type of bottle or strips, that could have given you some hint of that she's taken anti-thyroid drugs. And for rest of the students, I'll suggest that there are some shy students in each and every department and unit. Ask your colleagues who are little shy to present next time onwards. We don't want to listen at the every session and that we will pass you all. We want to pass each and every one. But the students who are making some initiative, they should also be encouraged to present. We don't mind if we don't get absolutely fantastic discussion. We must go to each and every doorstep. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Professor Raghumani, sir, your comment, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Well, as usual, you have done an excellent job. I think I remember you said somewhere around 120 or so the first clinical class. It's very good when you say it's 700 and probably it should go up. And all along, there's absolutely no problems in the video and audio. The quality is improving. As to the performance of the candidates, they should have a clear working knowledge and they should know how to edit a proper presentation. Whatever time available to them, they should rehearse themselves and they should come with a proper edited version. And they should not. The second candidate had two differential diagnoses of exactly opposite. No, these are the things you have to avoid. Yeah, differential different diagnosis should be in the order of priority. So at least when you, as you go along the presentation, you would have got an idea of what the examiners are vouching for, what they have had in mind. So you have to alter it. No, it's something like nowadays the T20 and rapid fire round. I think by and large, both candidates have done well. And Professor, examiners like Professor Abhay, all of us have become like Professor Abhay. And we are seeing the plus. Nam nadi, kutramum nadi, avatrul migai nadi, mikka kolal.
Sir, I think you should translate. This is a national forum. You should do it in English.
No, I just wrote it in English also. We see the plus and minus of the candidates. And so we take both and we arrive at the nice job, Kannagavel. Continue. Thank you,
sir.
Professor
Ilangavan,
sir.
Sir, it was a nice and wonderful effort. You have done a very good job. Actually, I think you take the knowledge to all the students all over the country. The first case presentation is slightly has to be improved. I think there are a lot of things, but the time given is more than 1 hour. But in the examination, there will be only, it's being a short case, it will be half an hour only. So they will ask very minimal question. They should be ready to answer. They should not bumble. And in the second case, even the presentation is not that much good, but he has answered the questions very well. It's a wonderful class. Thank you very much for that.
Abhay, sir, your closing comments, sir.
I can only say that both candidates were okay. Whatever candidates are listening right now, remember, when you present a case, even if examiner's eyes are closed, he should be able to know at the end of the hearing what are you leading them to. and it should be compounded by your examination findings coming to a proper diagnosis or differential diagnosis. If you can achieve that level, then you have got through for sure. Rest of the discussion is only going to increase your marks. So remember one thing, when you are practicing these presentations, whether it is long case or short case, try and make somebody sit in front of you with eyes closed, present your case. At the end of your history examination, ask that PG or your friend of yours, what is your diagnosis? If the diagnosis hit hard, then that's all I can say. I will come back to you. Just to add, since I have been asked to close, all these days, Dr. Kanakwal had a nice green background. Today, he has really got constellations behind him, as I see. So we are improving day by day and seeing brighter sides behind Kanakwal. I will try and get something behind me rather than the wall that I'm sitting in my room. Yes. Thank you.
Sir, in fact, before closing, I should put on record. Today, we had observer from RCS team from Wales Hospital, King George Hospital, Wales. There was an observer, but he said, we are only for observation. There is no official participation, so they don't want to come on the screen. They stayed with us all through. And in fact, I should thank Abhay sir for bringing in the industry to have an observer also to see how this can be done. Thank you, Abhay sir, for getting us the help. Vivek sir, are you with us? Vivek sir? I'm not sure. Vivek sir?
I think he has a
challenge, you know. With that, I would like to... Hitesh sir, you want to tell something? Please, sir.
I think at the end, we should ask the two participants also, what did they feel? If it is...
Sir, I think Maresh is there and both Dhaval is there. Maresh, can you switch on your video and give your words? Do you want to ask the examiners anything? What you want to improve upon? Dr. Maresh?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Do you want to ask anything to the examiners? Because it is time to take advice for you to get improved.
Or
next time you call the KMPG, now you can ask if you want to improve on or you want some questions to be clarified, please ask now.
Or feedback, whatever.
I am not coming as examiner, don't worry.
No, sir, like they should learn. In fact, longer exam. In fact, Ilangovan sir was telling the exams are short. But here, more questions, more possible questions in a teaching session. The candidate is already having a lead how to answer if and if he or she is asked. So I would say, please permit us to keep a longer session for every case, because when we tried 3 cases, then we had difficulty because we don't do justice. For 2 cases today, we have spent 2.5 hours. I think people can allow us to take in the right perspective. Maresh, you can ask your questions.
No, sir. It was a good discussion. I mean, it was overall good assessed by so many consultants and so many professors. I think I love to improve a bit and I grew a lot.
Right perspective and you try to get aligned up fast before you go to the exam. Dr. Dhaval, are you around here? Dr. Dhaval from KEM?
Yes, sir.
You can come on, switch on the video and ask your questions if you have any.
Yes, sir. I'm not having any questions, sir. It was an excellent discussion. I got the learnings from a lot of faculties and points I need to improve, I have mentioned. I have noted down the points where I need to improve myself. And no more questions. I am enjoying each and every session of this case discussion, sir.
Thank you. Sir, I think, Abhay sir, I should apologize. When you said the vascular case, there are 2 PGs have tried to reach out to me, it seems. One is the Dhaval Vasa and the other one is Dhanashri Mohit. Both the candidates said they have a vascular case. So then I said yes to both the candidates. So one candidate could not present. I asked her to present on Tuesday, sir. Apologies for that.
No problem.
Sir, Prabal sir, you want to close?
Sir, no, I don't want to close. I just wanted to see if any of the... There are many residents who are watching this and listening to this. Could we have maybe comments from any one of them? I can see a lot of people from my distinct department also. And I can see Rijuta is there. Quite a few people are there. Can somebody comment and you come up on this thing? And how was your... Did you learn something new? or what was the content like, so that we get a feedback for us consultants. How so to
maybe I can request one of the PGs to raise the hand so that I will unmute you to talk, please.
What is the JLL sir opinion?
JLL sir, I think you were away. I thought you're back. Welcome, sir. You want to give the closing comments? By the time I will take feedback from the students, please message me private who all want to speak. I will allow one by one for the PGs to speak. JLL sir, before that, closing comments, please.
No, sir, it was really good, but only thing, I'm a little disappointed because the students, we are giving the chance for you to come and present the case, and you have enough time to read the subject. Comparing with the previous days, what we have today, there is a little wavering in the minds of the students. And every subject, every case, and it is available in the YouTube also. That is a great asset. So I will only appeal to all the PGs. Please go and again look into this YouTube, because this is the most of these, some of these questions which is likely to come in the examination, because it is a vast variety of examiners and interested. Especially there is a pattern of examination difference in both in a DPNP examination and a PG examination conducted in a medical college. When we are mostly in the PG examination in a medical college, definitely all the science and clinical examinations, even if it is not that very mandatory, it will be also interested to ask the questions. But of course, in a DPNP, it will be in a different type of a question answer. So both the kind, I mean, as you are preparing for a PG, both any examination, any test, though which is obsolete, if it is obsolete and if you feel that in your institution you are not doing, there is no need to mention that. But if you are mentioning that examination pattern, and you should do it in the right way. That is, otherwise you will get into a problem. But both the students were finally able to manage when they come for the management part, and the treatment part, and they have done extremely good. So I congratulate them. But basic anatomy and basic physiology also, please concentrate and read more so that you will be able to be in excel in your examination without any fear. As rightly pointed out by Abhay sir, that the second candidate, when you are answering, you are looking here and there, and that gives a wrong signal. So please always have a straight look, positive look, and with a boldness addressed to the answers, and that will be always good. So my hearty congratulations to all the participants. Can I, well, sir, I am so happy today to see in the first trick, our Indian Medical Association emblem was there in the beginning of your screen. I'm so happy to see that.
Actually, that was of the yesterday's lecture we gave, I had, sir, because I don't want to, IMA, I don't know, I don't have the permission to show any emblem, sir. At this
No. It is really good, and we were so happy to see that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So with that, I am to inform, Tuesday we have two cases lined up. Now I'm getting slowly feedback from the students, what are the cases to be discussed. But in the problem of COVID, I think most of the hospitals do not have an inpatient, elective inpatient admissions. So as we go more and more, once the lockdown opens, like it is not going to open up immediately. So till that point, maybe allow me to discuss the more common cases. So we have potentially retroperitoneal tumor and other things are waiting for presentation on Tuesday. So I would also please request the faculty to join in at your convenience. It is only for the sake of operational ease, I'm quoting certain faculties to take lead to discuss. In fact, Abhay sir, JLL sir, Hitesh sir and all, I think they have become part of us and they are always with us to align us. Prabal sir, I would like to request you to do that. Jyoti ma'am, whoever the faculty, many faculty are called. Abhay sir, please.
No.
With that, I would like to close. I think
I'm pointing finger at Prabal. Madam is always there.
Yes, sir.
Prabal is a person, if you can catch him, it will do wonders.
Yes, sir.
He can shut off the screen for some time if he wants, like I do. That's a different terminology.
Yes, sir. Prabal sir, in fact, I spoke to him over phone. We know each other when we have met before.
Yes, of course.
He was very kind enough to immediately say, in fact, he had some other meeting. He was telling he may go off. He had to adjust it and put in record for the kindness that he has shown to be part of us. So with that, with the permission of the faculty, all the faculty do have my number. Please feel free to correct me, guide me, so that eventually the standard of academics, I'm sure it is going up in the last 5 classes. Please allow me to think about how to improve the standards or how to reach more students. Because faculty time is so very precious. I'm sure all of you are having important responsibilities. This should reach more number of students. One thing to close, we have 889 watches for this class. And put together, we have crossed 5,000 watches in all the classes put together. So I'm sure it is reaching more and more people. Let it become a regular routine. And please call me up, pull me up if I need to improve on certain areas where we can work on improving the quality of academics. So with that note, I will take permission on behalf of all the faculty to close down the session. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, postgraduates, for presenting both from KM and MS Ramya. Thank you for the respective unit chiefs for allowing them to present. Thank you, one and all. I am signing off for the day. Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam.